by the immune system, right? Basically, the immune system that you have confers or gives protection to you from any external environment, pathogen or chemical that might be associated with it. Now, how does it give you protection? Is by one process which is surveillance. So surveillance is the constant check of the immune cells that is taking place in your body, scanning for anything that may be foreign or not known to the immune system as cell. Okay? Surveillance has two components. You have a group of cells which are mainly the antigen-presenting cells. Which you also call as APCs. Amongst these antigen-presenting cells, you have the dendritic cells and the macrophages as the professional antigen-presenting cells. In addition to dendritic cells and macrophages, you have another cluster of cells which are known as B cells that are able to carry out what you call as antigen-presenting. Now, these cells typically, in addition to the B cells, circulate between two parts of your body. They are either stuck between the lymphatics or they're found circulating in the bloodstream. Two cells tend to remain restricted to the lymphatics and the bloodstream. And these two cells are the B cells and the T cells. Okay. The antigen-presenting cells, the dendritic cells and the macrophages, need to be at sites where they can see antigens, right? And where do antigens come into your body when you have an infection? So what are the key sites from where you can have infections? Sorry? Very good. So all your body is primarily protected because of the barrier function it has, okay? And barriers are maintained by one major cell type, which are epithelial cells, okay? Now, these epithelial cells can be on the skin, where they found, where it is stratified squamous epithelium keratinized, and therefore act as a main barrier, or they can be in the lining of the mucosa, in the oral cavity, in the upper GIT, where it is again stratified squamous epithelium, but non-keratinized. As you go deeper down, the layer tends to thin down and you end up having still epithelia but single cell lining, which becomes your columnar cells. Regardless of whatever the thickness, it's primarily the epithelial barrier that acts as an interface between the outside environment and what's inside. Therefore, the cells that need to make sure they carry out immune surveillance or they need to keep a check for any breach in the barriers or any breakdown in the barriers need to be at the site of the barriers. And the cells that are found just under them are your dendritic cells that are always tissue resident. And dendritic cells are called dendritic cells because they have long dendrite-like projections. You have a small cell body and long processes. And these processes are important because they increase the surface area of these cells, so they can actually end up identifying, coming into contact with any pathogen. Okay? Apart from these dendritic cells, you have the macrophages. The macrophages, as long as they're in circulation, these cells are typically your monocytes. Monocytes are large dentate nucleated cells that are found in your circulation produced by the bone marrow. And the moment they move out of your blood vessel into the tissue, in the tissue space you have what you call as the extracellular matrix. One component of the extracellular matrix is hyaluronic acid. Okay, Hyaluronic acid is typically found in greater concentrations in joints particularly, but it's also a part of the extracellular matrix which is surrounding the cells. So the moment your monocytes move out of the blood vessels, come into contact with hyaluronic acid, these monocytes mature. What do we mean by maturation? They enlarge in their size. Okay, they have kind of a wavering cell membrane around them, and they start producing lots of vesicles. They upregulate their mitochondrial functionality, enlarge to become macrophages. Okay, so your typical monocytes, the moment they leave the blood vessel and come out in the tissue, they mature. This interaction with the tissue with hyaluronic acid through a receptor on the surface, CD44, helps them to mature. And once they mature, they become tissue resident macrophages. Now the function of the macrophages and the dendritic cells in the tissue is primarily to keep carrying out the surveillance just below the lining of the epithelium. Okay? So the first cells that you can imagine that will come into contact with any pathogen is either going to be a dendritic cell or a tissue resident macrophage. So that's what your immune system essentially does. Okay? It basically carries out surveillance. Now that brings us to an important question: what are they carrying out surveillance for? So what do you think these immune cells are surveying for? Pathogens, right? What are pathogens now? That's the next question.
Foreign antigens.
Sorry?
Foreign antigens or foreign proteins.
Okay, so pathogens are foreign proteins. Can you try to make it better than that? This was a bad pen to use. What do you mean? What are pathogens? What is the difference between a pathogen and a commensal? Good. A pathogen can cause a disease. Can a commensal not cause a disease?
It can, but it takes over. It's not in the right proportion.
So, basically, commensal organisms are those that are found primarily outside the epithelial bag. They have not gone through the epithelial bag. Okay, that's one. So any commensal that is able to breach the epithelial barrier and go in will eventually cause disease. Okay, or goes to a different location. So how do pathogens cause disease to begin with? What are the typical characteristics that are required by pathogens to give rise to infections? Listening?
To stimulate the immune system.
Sorry?
Stimulate the immune system.
Good, okay. That's one. Second? What's the first thing that a pathogen needs to do?
Release or act as a toxin to the...
Exactly. So the first thing that a pathogen needs to do is to gain access. Okay? A typical pathogen, like we said, they're all outside your body. So the first thing the pathogen needs to do is to breach through the epithelial barrier and get into the body. Let's say this is the outside. From the outside, they need to get into the inside of the body. And why do they need to do that? Why do pathogens need to come from the outside and gain access to inside of your body?
There's no other way to
Okay.
Nutrients.
Sorry?
Nutrients.
There you are. So the outside environment is not supportive of pathogens to proliferate and enjoy life, right? So the best place where you would enjoy life is right here on planet Earth. I throw you on Mars without oxygen, you would barely survive. I would definitely not survive. So a pathogen does not have a temperature outside the body, nor the nutrients outside your body, for it to really carry out its function of progeny and expansion. Therefore, any pathogen that is there, it needs to gain access and gain entry inside your body, because inside your body, you have something very important, and that is your blood circulation that is maintaining a constant supply of oxygen. It is providing a good source of glucose plus amino acids, which are your nutrition that are primarily there, along with a temperature of 37 degrees Celsius, which is really essential for all the enzymatic functionality inside different bacteria, for them to kind of have an optimal enzymatic functionality for their proliferation and functions. Other than that, you may have viruses that tend to get in. Viruses even need the inside of a cell to carry out its transcription and translation to multiply. So whatever the pathogen is, it needs to gain access. For a pathogen to gain access, normally, most of them use receptors on the surface of epithelia, okay, to bind to them and get transported in. Alternatively, some pathogens can secrete toxins that can damage the lining of your epithelia, creating a break in the barrier and thereby gaining access. Okay, so eventually, whether the pathogen is bacteria, virus, parasite, or a fungus, it needs to breach the epithelial barrier to get inside. Once it's inside, it needs to use the resources that is already available for its own multiplication, proliferation, and survival. Now, the immune system's job, therefore, is to, and these barriers can be broken down at different levels. So you can just have an injury coming in, physical manifestation of an injury, that can lead to the loss of the epithelial barrier and the pathogens coming in. So the immune system, therefore, is responsible for carrying out something called as immune surveillance at a constant rate, either by macrophages or dendritic cells. Now, the macrophages and the dendritic cells that are available just next to the epithelial barriers, just below them in the extracellular matrix, both of them carry out what you call as sampling of the environment. Remember, both of these cells do not have any eyes and ears to see what's around in their environment. So they have to constantly carry out what you call as low level of phagocytosis. What do we mean by low level of phagocytosis? Is that, is there something wrong with this board or my marker is enough? What do we mean by low level of phagocytosis is that if you have normal cells, a macrophage will just come next to a normal cell and just pinch off the part of the cell and eat it up, leaving the rest of the cell to remain as is. Okay? So this is the normal sampling that a macrophage does. The macrophage can even just try to send two pseudopods around itself. Okay? And whatever is in the extracellular matrix, it will internalize it as a vesicle and then mutate it. Okay? So macrophages are at a very low level constantly carrying out sampling of the environment. In addition to this function of the macrophages, what they do is any cell that has aged, and this cell is just dying because of apoptosis, which is programmed cell death, right? Because it may not be required anymore. Macrophages are the cells that come in and phagocytose the apoptotic bodies that are being released. Now, this kind of cellular turnover, meaning cell creation and then cell death, is typically happening at a constant rate in all parts of your body, okay? And you can see this happening more prominently in cases of rapid generation and degeneration. typically when it happens in pregnancy, for example, or when people go for anabolic activities, go for functionality and then stop. So you increase this, for example, if people go to the gym and start exercising, forget about the muscle, even the epithelia has to expand because the skin is pushed more to increase in size. And then when they stop, it all has to go back again. So all this increase and decrease needs to constant increment, upregulation of cells, and decrement, downregulation of cells. Those cells that are being killed by apoptosis taken up by the macrophages. Now, all of this, the process of phagocytosis we talked about, this is called as receptor independent phagocytosis. Because macrophages carry out low level of phagocytosis at all times, not using any of their cell surface receptors. Macrophages on their surface have two major receptor types that are responsible for assisting phagocytosis. One receptor is called as Fc receptor, which recognizes the antibodies, and basically it recognizes the Fc part of the antibody. The other receptor that they have are Cr receptors, which basically are complement receptors, Cr1 particularly, which recognizes the complement C3b or C5 on the target cells. Okay, so macrophages basically are responsible for carrying out this low level of phagocytosis at all times, and which could be receptor mediated or non-receptor mediated. Now, what happens when a macrophage basically ends up carrying out phagocytosis? Let's convert this cell into a macrophage, okay, just for the sake of convenience. Once anything has been internalized in a phagosome, the products, as the phagosome moves more deeper into the cytoplasm from the surface, small adapter proteins come to the surface and guide it towards going deeper into the cell. In addition to that, it develops proton pumps come and get incorporated onto this membrane. What are proton pumps? What is a proton? Hydrogen. H plus. Okay. So as they move deeper into the cytoplasm, more H ions are pumped into it using ATP, active transport mechanism. And because of this, the pH inside this vesicle drops. At the same time, you have other vesicles released, which are called lysosomes. And these lysosomes come and fuse with the phagocytic vesicle or the phagosome. The lysosome already has enzymes that are proteolytic, meaning it has got enzymes that will break down proteins. However, itself, these enzymes that are there within the lysosomes, they are acid stable, meaning that there's a low pH, it does not tend to denature proteins, okay? Proteins typically lose their 3D structure or get denatured when you have either an increase in temperature, right? That's why we cook food, or you have changes in pH, whether too alkaline or too acidic, both of them will deform the typical structure of a protein. So in this particular case, the enzymes that are within the lysosomes have a three-dimensional structure that does not get altered if the pH drops. So their enzymatic functionality remains. Therefore, they're called as acid-stable proteases, or acid-stable hydrolases, because basically a protease carries out hydrolysis. It takes a chain of amino acids, add water to them and breaks them up. Okay, because single amino acids, when they link with each other to form a peptide chain and then a long protein chain, it's basically a dehydration reaction. Water is removed from them. So these enzymes basically add back the water molecule. Therefore, they're called as acid stable hydrolases or proteases. This leads to the breakdown of all the protein component that has been internalized by these macrophages that have been sampling their environment. Whether that protein is a part of the membrane of the cell or an apoptotic body, or whether that protein is an internal structure inside as the cytoskeleton of what is being internalized. Regardless of whatever they take in, those proteins are broken down. Furthermore, you have other enzymes that come in that break down lipids and act as lipases. And they break down all the lipid content that was there in the membrane, the phospholipids that are there. So essentially, in anything that is internalized is broken down into its basic components. If it's lipids, they're broken down into small free fatty acids. If it's a three-dimensional large protein, it is fragmented into peptide chains, small peptides. Once this is done, whatever is in the phagolysosome, because now the lysosome is fused to it, these amino acids or peptide sequences from this have two essential endpoints. One is whatever is internalized is again secreted out of the cell. This whole vesicle fuses with the membrane, and all the products that have been broken down are released into the extracellular space. The other option that can happen is that you have another vesicle that can bud off, and all these vesicles are coming from the Golgi apparatus primarily. So you have the endoplasmic reticulum from where things move to the Golgi, and from there they bud off as well. Here you have a particular set of proteins called MSC class 2. This can temporarily fuse with this phagolysosome. Whatever is the peptide sequence available in abundance gets loaded onto it, and then it can go onto the cell surface, carrying that peptide sequence with it, and therefore carrying off what is called as antigen presentation. Right? Therefore, our cells that we talked about, the two major cells, the macrophages and the dendritic cells, both are called antigen presenting cells, because essentially they have all the machinery to carry out phagocytosis, break down the products that are taken up in the phagosome, either secrete them to the immediate environment or load them onto MHC class 2 and put them on the surface. Okay, so that's why they're called as antigen presenting cells. Now this brings us to the question, what is an antigen? What do you think is an antigen? I'll just skip these useless slides.
Anything that can stimulate or that it stimulate the immune system?
Anything that has the capacity to stimulate the immune system. What do you think has the capacity to stimulate the immune system?
Proteins.
Why? Why not glucose? Why not sodium chloride?
Like to react with the receptors?
Okay. So antigens typically are molecules that have some degree of complexity in their nature. Okay. By that, if you look at the available complex macromolecular structures that are in your environment, proteins are at the top of the list. Okay. Apart from proteins, you can also have lipids or lipoproteins that are conjugations of lipids with proteins, and nucleic acids. All these three are really complex structures that are found in the environment, meaning they can have many, many, many different conjugations and components to it.
Also
conjugated polysaccharides. But when you come down to very simple components, okay, like glucose, sodium chloride, they are not, it's like throughout different species, it's the same glucose, right? You will just have a LEVO or a destro conformation, but essentially that's the only change that you will expect in between different species across the planet Earth. Same with sodium chloride. So there's not enough complexity in them. Therefore, they do not tend to act as antigens. So antigens typically are large complex molecules that have the capacity to basically show differentiation in between different species or components. Okay, so that's why the most antigenic substance that we think about, and we think about in global terms, are your proteins. Then anything that is linked to proteins,
you end up with
lipoproteins. Then you have polysaccharides, and then you have nucleic acids chain. Now, interestingly enough, when you take all of these and you break them down into their most simplest elements, for example, if you take proteins and they're broken down into amino acids, if you take down lipids and you just make them into free fatty acids, or you make them into monosaccharides, and you just talk about different nucleotide DNTPs, they by themselves are non-antigenic. Okay? So it's the combination of them that acts as antigens. And very rightly stated, antigens are typical substances that have the capacity to activate the immune system, or in simpler terms, be recognized by the immune system as something that is different. Now, the functions of the macrophages and the dendritic cells is not per se to recognize antigens. They don't do that. They don't carry out antigen recognition. But what they do is they carry out antigen display for recognition. They grab the antigens and put them on the surface so that the antigens can be recognized. And that's why they are called as antigen presenting cells. They're basically showing to their immediate environment what are these particular antigens that are available. Now, having said that, anything that is conjugated and put on the surface with MHC molecules has to be purely of protein origin, because MHC molecules do not conjugate with anything else except proteins that are broken down into small chains of peptides. Okay? Remember, single amino acids are not recognized. It's very important for you to know this. Whole protein can be recognized, but not in the context of MHC. Because what has happened over here within the phagosome is that the whole protein has been fragmented and broken down. Okay? So this is one of the key questions that comes up in one format or the other within the questions from USMLE, whether amino acids can be recognized as single sequences or whole proteins can be recognized in the context of MHC. Both are not possible. Okay? Amino acids by themselves are too small, they're non-antigenic. Whole proteins are antigenic, but because it went through the process of phagolysosomal degradation, they are not whole protein structures. They have been broken down by the phagosome into smaller fragments because of the acid stable hydrolases, and they are just available as peptide fragments. These peptide fragments, which is still a group of amino acids, are displayed on the surface. And these peptide sequences are what you call as antigenic, and they can be recognized by the environment. So your antigen presenting cells are typically involved in carrying out antigen breakdown of the large complex proteins and carrying out antigen processing and presentation. Now at the same point, you notice that they release them to their immediate environment. Okay? These peptide sequences that are released to the immediate environment are similar to what was the peptide sequences that were loaded onto them. Therefore, you can have other macrophages that are around that may not be actually taking the phagocytic process directly by engaging the pathogen, but they would be simply sampling their environments that we talked about earlier. And they can again take these sequences in them and put them onto surface. Third, and most importantly, these fragments, because this is happening at the tissue level, they may simply be drained by the lymphatics and go to the localized lymph nodes, and within those lymph nodes you have different groups of dendritic cells that are sitting in the lymph nodes called plasmacytoid dendritic cells. We'll discuss them later in detail. That can again take up these fragments and display them within the lymph node itself.
Shouldn't toll-like receptors be engaged to phagocyte the extracellular matrix?
Toll-like receptors are not required for the phagocytic process. Toll-like receptors are very important, what you call as pattern recognition receptors that are found on the surface of these macrophages and dendritic cells and B cells. But their function is to, once they get engaged, is to activate them and change behavior of these macrophages. For instance, when a toll-like receptor or a pattern recognition receptor is engaged on the surface of either a macrophage or a dendritic cell, it tends to change their behavior internally. How does it do that? In a macrophage, apologies. So, the moment a macrophage is hit by the toll-like receptor, two changes principally happen. One, the macrophage is signaled, the signal goes to the nucleus of the macrophage, and the macrophage starts carrying out transcription and therefore translation of co-stimulatory molecules. So, normally, there are co-stimulatory molecules CD80 and 86 that are present on the surface of macrophages, but they are expressed in very, very low numbers. Once the toll-like receptor are engaged, or any pattern recognition receptor is engaged, there's a huge shift in the increase of CD80 and 86. Second change that happens in the macrophage, it carries out phagocytosis at a higher rate. Third, the MHC class II molecules are synthesized in increased number, so that it can carry out more antigen display on the surface. So a normal macrophage, when it is just sampling the environment, does not see a pathogen, does not see an antigen from external source. It will just have an X amount, a basal level of surface expression of MHC class II with self peptides, with the peptides that it is picked up from self cells that are dying, or just sampling the extracellular matrix which is there in the macrophages. Once the pattern recognition receptors are engaged, it will have a change in the behavior. Dendritic cells have a change in the behavior which is even more different. Dendritic cells, the moment they have an engagement through the pattern recognition receptors, they actually stop further phagocytosis. They increase more, they send more MHC class II molecules to whatever has been phagocytosed. Therefore, they have more dense antigen expression on their surface. Yani they will express more MHC class II molecules on the surface, and whatever has been already phagocytosed, they will stop. They do not want to dilute the antigen by sampling more things from the environment. Okay? Then the second change that comes into the dendritic cell is that it immediately starts migrating towards the lymphatics and starts going towards the lymph node. Third change, of course, is the same, increases the surface expression of CD80 and 86, which are co-stimulatory molecules. Okay? And fourth, both of these cells, once they have internalized, depending on the kind of toll-like receptor or pattern recognition receptor that is engaged, they start increasing also the synthesis of different cytokines. Okay? Now notice that your dendritic cell, the moment it phagocytoses something and its toll-like receptors or pattern recognition receptors is engaged, it stops further phagocytosis, increases the antigen expression, and it starts running towards the lymph node through the lymphatics. That's why the most potent antigen-presenting cell, or the strongest antigen-presenting cell that we talk about generally, is your dendritic cell, not the macrophage. Macrophages tend to remain within the tissue. A few of them may leave to the local lymphatics, but they tend to remain there. They do carry out antigen presentation, but they tend to carry out antigen presentation more at the tissue level. And macrophages typically are more helpful in kicking rise or giving rise to the memory immune responses, because they help to carry out antigen presentation for the tissue resident memory cells. But I think we jumped a little too far ahead. I was going very slow. So coming back to this, so what were the antigens? So your antigens are any large molecules that have the capacity to activate the immune system. And when we talk about the immune system, it's not activation of dendritic cells or the macrophages. By the activation of immune system, we mean activation of T cells and B cells that are actually present within the lymph nodes. Okay?
And what about the neutrophils and other
Yes, they do not act as antigen presenting cells.
So I mean, are they the immune system when they are activated, it does this, is this full?
We do not actually consider them in that context, but they are a part of the immune system, and they do not get activated. They get pushed into activation. Okay, we'll come to that.
One last question.
Yes.
This scenario happens in case of pathogen or also apoptotic bodies.
Come again.
This scenario happens for dendritic cells and macrophages in case of pathogens and also apoptotic bodies. They internalize apoptotic bodies. The same thing, they present it and the dendritic cells go to the lymphatics.
Good question. Pattern recognition receptors, under which you have toll-like receptors, NOD, dectin, the key families. Only when these are engaged, these give a signal to these cells for maturation or enhanced antigen presentation. If they are not engaged, then they just carry out basal phagocytosis in the tissue, remain in the tissue.
Okay. So they are not engaged in apoptotic body when
they will phagocytose an apoptotic body,
yeah.
And that's it. They will just remove the debris. Unless within the apoptotic body you had a virus. Unless the apoptosis is induced by an intracellular bacteria or another extracellular bacteria that is releasing toxins. In that case, although it is removing the apoptotic body, its toll-like receptor or the pattern recognition receptor is engaged, then it is going to move to carry out antigen presentation. If the pattern recognition receptors are not engaged, they carry out a low level, a basal level of phagocytosis just to remove what is in their environment. However, we can come to that later. There are instances where they can get activated softly. We'll discuss that later. That comes in cases of extreme apoptosis. Okay, and that's where autoimmunity can kick in, where they are in the process of removing self, but the self proteins, the self peptides, and particularly the DNA, since he's pushed it in, so I'll talk about that. The DNA in apoptotic bodies becomes unmethylated and it mimics the DNA that is present in bacteria. And in those cases, if there's too much apoptosis happening and it gets mimicked similar to what is bacteria, it will actually carry out antigen presentation similarly. And that is where the probability of having autoimmune disorders increases. So people who already have autoimmune disorders like SLE, systemic lupus erythematosus, rheumatoid arthritis, the moment they have any other infection, forget SLE. Let's say that, God forbid, I got SLE, and now I get exposed to just the regular flu, okay? Or I just get a regular influenza infection. Now my immune system is going to be responding to the influenza, but at the same time, the antigen processing and presentation going back to the lymphatics within the lymph node will also end up activating the autoreactive memory B cells and T cells that are targeting my own body in SLE. So the problem that you have in cases of autoimmunity is that any infection that comes in, it ends up giving a flare or an increment to the autoimmune response that pre-exists in that person. It has to pre-exist. You have to remember that. Okay? Right. So any questions still here? We did a very simplistic overview of what is antigen processing, and we'll move in detail to what is antigen presentation later again. This is just to give you a holistic overview of what is happening. Now, we were talking about antigens. I'm going to start focusing a little more on antigens. So your antigens typically are coming from bacteria, viruses, fungi, parasites, and proteins. And your immune system is able to recognize antigens by two main receptor types. You have a cell called as a B cell and another cell called as a T cell. B cells on the surface have a receptor called a B cell receptor. T cells on the surface have another receptor called the T cell receptor. Now, B cell receptors are typically same as an antibody, except that they have an extra domain that helps them anchor or bind into the bilipid cell membrane of the B cell. So B cell has a plasma bilipid layer on top, and the typical antibody has just a few extra amino acids that help it to anchor or bind to this bilipid layer. The rest of it, the rest of the structure is typically that of the antigen. Same is the case for the T cell receptor, that the T cell receptors have membrane anchoring domains. So the amino acid sequences that are going to be found in these membrane anchoring domains are typically hydrophobic. Why would they be hydrophobic? Because the membrane is a bilipid layer, right? And the central part of the cell membrane is rich in lipids, and it is organized in a manner that the heads of the phospholipids are associated with the water molecules both outside the cell and inside the cell. So the amino acid sequences that are found in these anchoring domains have to be such amino acids that do not like water, hydrophobic amino acids, and they are lipophilic. They like to integrate or make bonding and interactions with lipids. Therefore, they will have stronger interaction with the bilipid layer around them and tend to anchor the receptors over there. Okay, now the B cell receptor and the T cell receptor by itself are used for recognizing the antigens, but they are not able to signal inside the cell what they have tried to recognize on the outer surface. To be able to signal inside the cell, they need additional proteins that help them carry out this function. For the B cell, they have immunoglobulin IG alpha IG beta domains, which have larger cytoplasmic domains. So these two additional proteins have longer cytoplasmic sequences than the B cell receptor in itself. Okay? For the T cells, you have a complex of CD3 proteins that have longer cytoplasmic tails than the TCR itself, along with another set of proteins called as the zeta chains. Now, although the recognition of the antigen is taking place by the BCR or the TCR for the T cells and the B cells, but signaling that has to go inside the cell that they have actually recognized something on the outside is not taking place by them, but with associated proteins that are there. Now, for the T cells, we know that they have additional proteins that help in the overall functionality. One of them is the CD4 protein. And on another T cell, with the T cell receptor, you may have another protein which is called as the CD8. On the B cells, similarly, you have two additional proteins, CD19, 20. Okay? These additional proteins are basically required to enhance the signal that you get from the outside towards the inside. And over here, the CD4 or the CD8 proteins that are there are responsible for helping the T cell receptor to recognize either MHC class 2 molecule for the CD4 and the MHC class 1 for the CD8 T cell. Okay? So although these are the peptide or the antigen recognizing sequences, and they are associated with additional proteins that help to signal inside the cell if they have actually seen the antigen, they still need another group of cell surface receptors for them to assist in carrying out this whole process. Okay? Now, together, the T cell receptor with these additional proteins that are involved in signaling downstream, this whole thing is known as the T cell receptor complex. Okay. Similarly, for the B cell, you call this whole cluster together as the B cell receptor complex. Okay. Now, just be mindful that when you get questions coming in USMLE, be careful about what is the context of that question. Okay. If the question is really focusing on the molecular signaling aspects, okay, then keep a lookout for the word complex. Okay, otherwise, if they're not focused on this, they can simply say this whole thing is sometimes simply referred to the B cell receptor, and this whole complex is sometimes referred to as the TCR. If they're not focusing on the molecular part of it, meaning what signals inside the cell and what recognizes the surface, they will just call this as a TCR and the BCR, even if it is the whole complex in its totality. Okay? Right. Now, we were talking about the T cell receptor and the B cell receptor and their functionality in terms of carrying out antigen recognition. So these are the basic structure. Now, how do these two basic receptors on T cells and B cells carry out different kind of antigen recognition? Interestingly, the B cell receptor is able to recognize any 3D complex protein. Whereas for the T cell receptor, we already know that it is only going to be engaged by antigen presenting cells that are presenting the antigen either loaded onto MHC class 2 or MHC class 1. MHC class 1 is what we have not discussed till now, and I'm going to come back to that later. But typically, you need to understand that any peptide loaded onto MHC class 2 molecule or class 1 is going to be recognized by the TCR, meaning that this whole complex protein has already been fragmented and broken down into peptide sequences, and now they are being presented. This can also mean that this whole complex protein can have an antigenic sequence inside of it that is not on the surface, that the T cells can recognize, but not the B cells. Okay? So remember, B cells recognize whole 3D structures. They can recognize whole proteins. They can recognize lipoproteins. They can recognize nucleic acid sequences. They can recognize polysaccharides. So B cells carry out recognition of all the complex molecules we discussed earlier. You remember when we listed them down? Whether they are proteins, whether they are lipoproteins, whether they are polysaccharides, whether they are nucleotide sequences. All of them are recognized by the BCR. So the BCR has the capacity to do that. But the TCR...
But not in the context of the MHC.
Not in the context of MHC. Excellent. Yes, thank you for clarifying that. Not in the context of MHC. They recognize them as they are, either fragmented or not fragmented, but as independent structures. T cells can only recognize peptide fragments that are loaded onto MHC. Therefore, when we talk generally about antigens, right? Remember earlier I said that proteins are stronger antigens as compared to nucleic acids, because if you take a protein as a foreign antigen, the protein will activate B cell and T cells. But if you take a nucleic acid or a if you take a polysaccharide antigen, a polysaccharide antigen will activate B cells, but not the T cells. Okay? So stronger antigens therefore eventually end up being proteins in the nature, and they can have both the 3D structure of the protein, the whole surface, that can be recognized by the B cell receptor, or something inside that is not displayed on the surface of the 3D protein, like for example the ink nib inside this cap is not recognized unless it is broken down. So the cap itself will be recognized by the BCR, and the cap, a part of the cap may be recognized by the TCR, but this broken down nib of this pen is primarily only going to be recognized by the TCR and not so much by the B cells. Okay? These segments of antigens that are recognized are called as epitopes. Now, biologically, we say that this whole protein is an antigen, meaning this whole protein has the capacity to activate the immune system. But when you look at the protein structure and you try to identify which part of this protein has the ability to activate the immune system, it is not all of it. There are segments of it that may be able to activate the available B cells and the available T cells. These segments that are available to carry out antigen, that actually are able to carry out antigen recognition and activation, are called as epitopes. Epitopes are the sites which are actually recognized by the B cell receptor and the T cell receptor. These epitopes may be on the surface for the B cells, but could also be inside the three-dimensional configuration of the protein and therefore not be recognized by B cell unless this protein is broken down. The ones that are inside are called as cryptic epitopes. Cryptic means hidden. Okay? And cryptic epitopes are specific for T cells only, not the B cells. Okay? Does that make sense? Good. So this is how the antigens that are available are typically recognized. Now, there are places, there are certain circumstances under which the epitope that is there may be smaller than its actual presentation that needs to be taken place for recognition. For example, if you take this epitope, this one, and it gets further fragmented into smaller sizes, then these smaller portions will not be recognized again. So if the peptide sequence is broken down too much into singular amino acids, or just 2-3 amino acids together, again they will not be recognized. So it has to be of a considerable size. For MHC class 2, the size ranges between 14 to 24 amino acids. Some people write it down to 22. For MHC class 1, it ranges between 8 to 18, sometimes 22. Different books have different representations. So for MHC class 1, it is shorter peptide fragments. For MHC class 2, it is relatively larger peptide fragments. But if they are broken down into dipeptides, if the breaking down is that much, they will not be recognized. Okay? Now, that brings us to another very interesting phenomenon. If these di-tripeptides are available, these small sequences are available, and if they end up getting deposited on the surface of another protein, and this sequence was complementary to the part that was cleaved off. Okay? Now again, it somehow acts as a complete antigen. Do you understand what I'm talking about? And this, therefore, these things that by themselves cannot activate, and in conjugation they can, these are typically haptens. Okay? So hapten is a structure that is so small that by its own self it is not able to activate the immune system. But it has the antigenic capacity if it gets conjugated to another surface. Okay? So typically in those particular sequences, drugs, typically penicillins, right? This is the first question you ask in history taking when you go to a patient: are you allergic to any drugs? And the first thing that you're thinking in your mind is not a beta blocker. You're thinking about penicillins, typically. Penicillins can be act as haptens, and once they get stuck on the surface of platelets, rarely also on RBCs, but mainly on platelet surface, they can become, the whole structure together can become antigenic to be recognized by the B cells. And therefore, you can have a severe response if you give somebody penicillin and he's already allergic to it. Okay? Now, moving a little back to the epitopes, we were talking about sequences within the whole protein that can be antigenic. I just want to reiterate a very important point here. And a single B cell typically has one B cell receptor on its surface. By one, I don't mean in number, I mean in type. In numbers, there can be as much as 500,000. Okay? There are that many on the surface. So the cell itself is a whole universe. Okay? So single B cell will have a single type of B cell receptor, and you can have another B cell with a different kind of B cell receptor. Okay? One particular antigen or one particular protein can have multiple epitopes, meaning it can activate In this case, let's say these are three epitopes, it will end up activating three different B cells. So a single antigen can have a single epitope and activate one B cell. A single antigen can have multiple epitopes and activate multiple B cells. And this goes back to the concept that when you have different kinds of pathogens, right, some tend to activate the immune system more strongly, others tend to activate the immune system less strongly. It all goes back to the point that the antigen that is there, is it able to give rise to one, two, or three different epitope-based expansions? Now, these expansions that we talk about are clonal expansions. Meaning, if this B cell over here goes back and recognizes this particular epitope, this B cell will start expanding. Okay? And one of the most important feature is the amount of expansion. Because each time T or B cells expand, their receptors need to go bind to the epitope, get an activation signal, move away, divide into two. These two cells that are divided again need to go back to the epitope, engage it, get an activation signal, and then divide. Now there are four. The four will again go back. All four need to engage the epitope and divide. Now, if the amount of antigen is very less, you will start having a competition for the B cells to come for this antigen. So the B cells will expand, and then they will start competing for expansion because all of them cannot engage the antigen together. Some B cells will be left out. Okay? So the amount of antigen, therefore, dictates the amount of immune response. So if you've got a lot of antigen, a lot of B cells will have the chance to come back, get engaged, expand. Come back, get engaged, and expand. Therefore, in immunology, we talk about that the pathogen, the severity of the pathogen of the disease dictates the severity of the disease. Meaning, if somebody gets only four viruses coming into their body versus another person who incorporates 1 million. So the person who gets 1 million of the same virus will respond, will have a greater immune response, have a greater severity of disease, fall more sick than the person who gets less. Okay? So the amount of antigen is one factor that dictates the intensity of the immune response. Second is the number of epitopes. So you can have a single protein that has a single epitope, which will give rise to a single clonal expansion of one B cell type. If you have a protein that has got multiple epitopes, it will give rise to multiple B cell expansion. Okay? Yeah.
When does the clonal expansion stop? Is there a signal there?
Yes, the clone, that is exactly the antigen dose. So once the antigen is no more available for the B cells to keep getting a signal from, that's where they tend to stop. This is one. Second is once they've gone through a certain number of proliferative cycles, they start upregulating on the surface proteins that help them to leave the lymph node, okay, and move towards the tissue. So we're going to discuss them in detail as well. Yeah.
Isn't T regulatory cells also involved in stopping the clonal expansion, or?
We'll go into that together. That's a whole different area.
Okay, another question about clonal, you said, since they only get activated in the lymph nodes, they can be, because they don't need MHC and they don't need the dendritic cells. So can they be activated in the blood, the B cells?
B cells can get activated in the blood. That is also seen.
Yeah.
So but typically, the problem in blood is that the flow rate in circulation is so high. Remember, these interactions that take place are affinity based, not conjugation binding based. You see, when you have the double helix of the DNA, it is bound to each other by hydrogen bonds. These interactions that are taking place over here are not based on this T cell receptor or this B cell receptor binding to it. It is like an engagement. It is like my phone that is on the table, but if it goes slip, say there it goes. Okay? So it doesn't bind to it. So in circulation, the flow rate of the blood and the antigen is so high that even when they do come, it doesn't give enough time for the B cells to keep connected to the antigen long enough to get an activation signal. It bounces off. Therefore, the lymph nodes or the spleen or any secondary lymphoid structure, it can be the pear patches as well, they act as local environments where antigen levels are basically concentrated. Okay, so the lymphatics, when they are draining from, they're draining the antigen away from the site of inflammation, they're taking the lymph and depositing it in the lymph node. This lymph node becomes an area where a lot of antigen comes in and starts accumulating because the flow rate inside it is very low, and it is like a sieve, it's like a percolation. And over there you have plasmacytoid dendritic cells that are sitting there that capture the antigen and just let them be on their surface. Okay, which are different from the regular dendritic cells. And therefore, the amount of antigen that is available within the lymph node is way higher than what you will expect in the blood. In the blood, it also gets diluted. And therefore, it will carry out the antigen presentation. Second very important thing you need to remember is that it takes time for the correct B cell to come and engage the correct epitope. Okay? In your body, you have 1 into 10 raised to power 8 to 10 different B cells. Okay? And out of them, 1 or 3 or 5 B cells need to come and engage this particular antigen. The B cell that you're thinking of may be sitting in your popliteal lymph node. An inflammation that's happening is probably you had a cut in your hand or your arm, is happening in the axillary lymph nodes, okay, or supratrochlear lymph node. So in that case, it will take time for the B cell to come there. Therefore, antigens get concentrated and deposited within the localized lymph node, waiting for the correct B and the T cell to reach that area, and then antigen presentation and processing and activation takes it. And therefore, the clonal expansion takes place within those secondary lymphoid organ structures, and not just haphazardly in the circulatory blood. Okay? So are we okay with what the epitopes are? Okay? Now remember, this is an interaction that takes place. It's not a binding. Now, if you think about the antigen presentation that takes place for the T cell receptors versus that for the B cell receptors, first thing that you need to remember, this is a very fundamental question that pops in most of the time. So one thing is that your B cell receptors are able to recognize sequences other than peptides from amino acids. They can recognize lipids, nucleic acids, and complex carbohydrates like polysaccharide. Okay? T cells cannot do that. Second, most importantly, the epitopes that are present on an antigen can activate more than one clone, depending on the number of epitopes. Which is not really, which can happen for T cells, but for T cells, they are already fragmented down. Third, cryptic epitopes cannot help the activation of B cells. Cryptic epitopes are reserved for T cell activation because the protein structure needs to be broken down for that. Third, the whole, like he suggested, the whole process of antigen presentation is not required for B cells, but it is essential for T cells to take place. Okay? So your B cells have therefore a much more easier way of getting activated as compared to T cells to begin with. Okay? Does that make sense? You have any questions still here? Now, haptens also tend to activate B cells much more easily than the T cells, because for a hapten molecule to be activated, to go through the, to actually activate the T cell, this hapten complex plus this membrane, all of it together needs to go through antigen processing and presentation and then activate the relative T cells. Okay? So, take home messages. Number one, the dose of the antigen or the dose of the pathogen or the amount of the pathogen dictates the strength or the amount of the immune response. Okay? The type of the antigen, meaning how many epitopes it bears, acts as a secondary factor into determining the strength of the immune response that is generated out of it. Okay? And we'll go into detail where both T and B cells are important. Second important take-home message is it's not the B cell receptor itself that activates the B cell, it's the BCR complex and the TCR complex that activate it. Okay? By itself, they are just antigen recognition receptors. Having said that, they are not only antigen recognition receptors, but what is the outcome? Clonal expansion. That also means they are mitogenic cells. Okay? Yani, one outcome of B cell receptor complex engagement and one outcome of T cell receptor complex engagement, we can say they activate the immune system, yes, but how? The first step is clonal expansion. Therefore, they induce mitosis, and therefore they are called as mainly mitogenic signals. But after the mitogenic signal, of course, they change the behavior of these cells for them to start differentiating into the B cells, differentiate into plasma cells that secrete antibodies or become memory cells. Likewise, for the T cells to differentiate into different T helper subtypes, or for a CD8 to become a cytotoxic. So that is the second outcome of the activation. But the first and the most commonest outcome is clonal expansion, which is a mitogenic signal. Yes.
Yeah, when we think about the BCR complex or the TCR complex, this we include them like in the world complex, will have also the co-stimulatory
proteins? No.
So the complex itself cannot stimulate activate a cell, or
the complex itself is able to activate but not sustain it. Co-stimulation is required for sustaining the responses. Okay. Mm-hmm. By itself the T cell can get activated, and that's what happens. If you just take a T cell and take a peptide MHC molecule, which is without co-stimulatory molecules, you delete the genes for CD8 and 86. T cells do expand a little, but then stop. And that is what induces MHC. Okay? All right, we'll take a short pause here. You guys can stretch your legs, get coffee, wake up, and then we restart. How much time do we have?
11:15
right
now. 11:15 right now.
Oh, we just stopped 15 minutes?
No.
Down the second part of the session, so I have energy to get up for the third part. So I have to give myself small breaks. So the objectivity of today is to get through the global overview of the whole immune system, including the adaptive and innate. I will be focusing on pockets of the core essentials for the adaptive right now, and then we will try to finish the general. So I like to split immunology into two zones. One is general immunology, which focuses on basic cells, functions, and what they do. And then we go to immunopathology. Immunopathologies are directly, as the name indicates, the diseases and the abnormalities associated with it, which can be transplantation, autoimmunity, cancer, HIV, and immune deficiency syndromes, primary immune deficiency syndromes. Those we'll keep for the second 2 days. Okay, so today and tomorrow we'll try to go to the general overview and get the basics of the basic immunology course concepts inside. Okay, right. So what we paused before was talking about the clonal expansion, the role of the epitopes that are there. And I'm just going to focus and get certain points back in home again. So the point I want to hone in, or for you guys to focus on, is that in the adaptive immune system, although you have billions of different T cells and B cells, each single cell type has only one unique type of receptor on it. So a single B cell has a B cell receptor that will recognize one single epitope. That is what we mean by a single receptor with unique specificity. Single receptor, I repeat again, does not mean it is only one receptor on a B cell. There are millions of them, but all have the same structure in terms of affinity to bind to one particular epitope. Having said that, B cells by default have two kinds of receptors on their surface. The BCR can be either an IgM or it can be an IgD subclass. Okay, so even the IgM or the IgD subclass, both of them will have the same affinity for the epitope that they bind to. The affinity does not change. Now, the interaction that they have with the antigen on the surface of the lymphocyte receptor has to be of high affinity. What do we mean by affinity? What is affinity?
Strength of interaction.
The strength of interaction. What determines the strength of interaction?
Molecular structure itself.
Very good. Now this is important because this is weird. Okay, I don't mind, somebody's burning some fire somewhere. Okay. Affinity is talking about the molecular structure. Bear in mind that this molecular structure that we're talking about has got nothing to do with the bonding. Okay? Do not confuse affinity with the binding capacity. So let's say that this is a typical MHC, let me make it better. So MHC class 1 molecule has three immunoglobulin-like domains, alpha 1, 2, and 3. And it has got a beta 2 microglobulin unit there to kind of give this structure its 3D stability. Okay? Now within this peptide binding groove of MHC class 1, you have the peptides that are those that are oriented towards the MHC class 1 molecule and sequences that are oriented away from it. You get what I'm saying? So there will be the peptide sequence, the antigen will have some amino acids that like to interact with the MHC class 1 molecule, and those amino acids are oriented towards it. And then it has some amino acids that are oriented away from it. And the ones that are oriented away from it give rise to a certain topographic or 3D structure. And this 3D structure is what is going to be recognized by the alpha and the beta chain of the TCR. Now, this sequence that is available needs to be of a high affinity. It does not mean that it will have disulfide linkages. Okay? It just needs to have complementary amino acids on the other side that like to engage these crefts and troughs. They're like, you know, it's like a wave, and there are pockets that are formed. So this structure needs to be, if I go more molecular in detail, it will have a conformation where these amino acids tend to fit in or interact better with the TCR amino acids that are oriented towards. Okay? So this is what we're talking about, affinity. It needs to be of a high affinity. So you may end up with a situation where this interaction is taking place here and not in the groove. And therefore the affinity weakens in that case. And therefore the interaction does not remain of a strong affinity. And unless it is of that high affinity, lymphocyte activation will not take place. Okay? That's how one TCR is differentiated from a different TCR based on the different affinities it has for each epitope that we were talking about. Now, once the T cells get activated, all the effectors that are derived will be once this T cell gets activated, all the products that it has, essentially, will be clones, right? It's clonal expansion, exact copies, and the TCR they carry on their surfaces should have the same affinity for the peptide antigen as the original one. I use the term should have, okay? Because there's always a probability that during proliferation, during clonal expansion, there can be a chance that small mutations take place, right? Any cell that goes through the large, the more the cell divides, the greater the probability that a mutation can happen, okay? And therefore you may have it, but that is a very, very rare chance. Yes, ma'am?
If there is an affinity between the HMC and the TCR, but the interaction is under weaker intermediate in the string, will that lead to energy?
No. Energy is going to come from a different process altogether. So, good you bring it up. For a T cell to be fully activated, it needs three signals. One is the recognition of the TCR of the peptide MHC complex. This is, and of course, it is the CD complex, CD3, a TCR complex through the CD3 molecules and the zeta chain that signal. And this is called signal one, activation. On the same surface, here you have the antigen presenting cell, you have CD80, CD86 engaging CD28. This is signal number two, okay, which actually induces or allows signal one to complete and cause proliferation or survival. In the absence of CD28, complete activation does not take place. Okay, since he has ringed the bell, let's just take it down. What happens is, once the T cell receptor binds to the peptide MHC complex that it recognizes, that is the cognate, the one that it recognizes, cognition, cognate peptide MHC, it sends a strong signal inside the cell. This signal that goes inside the cell is supposed to activate mitotic genes. Okay, it's supposed to induce mitosis and proliferation. At the same time, the cell itself has an intrinsic negative feedback loop to block the signal. Okay, you do not want an unwanted T cell response. The CD80 and 86, when it engages CD28, it comes back and blocks the negative feedback, allowing the activation signal to fully continue so that clonal expansion can take place. The third signal that we talk about is usually by the cytokines that are secreted, and they act again on the DNA or the genome to carry out upregulation of certain genes in the progeny, therefore giving rise to what you call as differentiation. Differentiation means that the same cell that is using the same TCR over here to get activated, this signal of activation induces the proliferation capacity, and the signaling from the cytokines activates another set of genes for its effector function. In this case, we're talking about a CD8 T cell, right? MHC class 1. So this cytokine signaling will help this naive T cell start making more products through the mRNA of granzyme B and perforins, which are going to be the key secretory products once it acts as an effector T cell to kill the target cell. Okay, so it starts. So this cytokine signaling helps it to make cytotoxic products. So that's the effector functionality that is it. So signal one, activation, survival, and differentiation. Signal three. All three are required. Okay? In the absence of CD28 or co-stimulation, this cell will go through a number of expansions. It will just multiply two or go through two or four cycles. By that time, the negative feedback will come in. It will break down a lot of signaling proteins. This is not just a signal going in. There are many, many, many proteins that relay the signal from the surface all the way to the nucleus. So the feedback loop will degrade all of those proteins that are responsible for carrying the signal from the surface to the inside. And that's why we call this cell, which did not have CD80 and 86 signaling, we call this cell to become anergic. Anergic means there is still a TCR on the surface, but nothing is signaling inside for the cell to be activated. Okay? This is one of the ways by you prevent, or autoimmunity is prevented. So if during selection, you do not have cells that are negatively selected and you do not remove the autoimmune cells completely, and some autoimmune cells come to the periphery, if by chance they get activated, in the absence of co-stimulation, they get energized, right? And this is particularly important when we were talking about antigen processing and presentation. You remember, the baseline function of macrophages and dendritic cell was to keep sampling. And therefore, it constantly keeps presenting self-antigens to the immune system. And once it's presenting self-antigens to the immune system, it is sort of ensuring that if there is an autoreactive cell, it gets a signal, gets energized. Okay? So that's one of the outcomes of that process. Now coming back to the clonal selection hypothesis that we were talking about, when I'm talking about this interaction, it means signal 2 and 3 are also kind of taken, that they're already there. So these cells, the cells that expand have identical specificity of the TCR to that of the parent cell. They're same as the parent cell in terms of antigen or peptide recognition against which they get activated. And lymphocytes that are already having the self molecules, of course they were deleted during the processes of negative selection. So you only have a group of cells that recognize foreign antigens. They, even the progeny, recognize the antigen with the same affinity as the parent cell. Okay? However, there is a small exception. The exception lies in the context of B cells. Okay? B cells use the same B cell receptor to recognize the epitope on the antigen. Okay? Again, these B cells will go through the process of clonal expansion. But B cells have a very unique outcome. Why? Because B cells, when they're expanding, they also need T cell help, right? So what will this B cell do? It will recognize the antigen, and using the B cell receptor that binds to the antigen, apart from antigen recognition, it also internalizes this whole complex. So B cell can recognize the antigen at the same time the B cell can internalize this antigen via receptor-mediated endocytosis. This goes through the whole process similar to the macrophages that we talked about antigen presentation. And fragments of these antigens are put on the surface of MHC class II for antigen presentation. The T cell for the same antigen was activated in the lymph node by a dendritic cell or a macrophage, and now has differentiated into becoming an effector T cell, a T helper, CD4. This CD4 T cell, when it will come and try to recognize the peptide MHC through the TCR, of course it will release cytokines, but more importantly, it carries out one unique function. It leads to the engagement of CD40 ligand that induces an enzyme in the B cell called activation induced cytidine deaminase. This enzyme is responsible initially for the class switching of B cells, but each time the B cell gets helped by the CD4 T cell, this enzyme is activated even after class switching. So for the class switching, what happens is that this is the BDJ recombination that has taken place, constant mu, constant delta, and then let's say constant alpha. Let's say the class switching is taking place so that it becomes an IgA. So you have a VBJ constant alpha 1. This becomes its gene reconfiguration. Now let's say that this B cell is becoming a memory B, has become a memory B cell that is going to make IgA. So a group of these B cells will become plasma cells that are secreting the dimeric IgA. Is that clear? Now the memory B cell that you have, upon the second activation, CD4 comes and interacts with this memory B cell, CD40 ligand engagement takes place, and activation induced cytidine deaminase is kicked in again. Now the activation induced cytidine deaminase initially was acting on these switch regions to make the cut and carry out the class switching that is going to take place from either IgM or IgD to an IgA. Okay? But what happens over here is now when it's activated to this sequence, it starts inducing point mutations anywhere. If the point mutations are induced here, which is the constant region, nothing really happens. It's not going to change the functional outcome. Okay? But if point mutations take place in the VDJ recombinated area, you may have a new amino acid introduced or changed that can either have a higher affinity or a lower affinity for the same antigen. Okay? If it has got a lower affinity, the cells that have higher affinity will combine to the antigen in preference and get a stronger signal, and this clone will die off. This mutated clone will die off over time because it will not get a signal for stimulation. If, however, the mutation leads to increased affinity, then the parent one, okay, it will bind to the antigen with slightly stronger affinity than the original B cell that got activated and went through the process of class switching, and will bind stronger to it, and that clone will expand more, the mutated clone. This thing is called as affinity maturation. So the affinity is increased due to repetitive activation, and that's the kind of outcome sometimes we try to reach by repetitive doses of vaccines that we want to give. Again, this is very, very crucial in the context of what you call as antigenic drift. Every year, people end up having flu infections. Okay? And that's primarily because the virus has a very unstable genome. It can mutate very easily and drift away from its parent viral status. Similarly, the immune system, therefore, also has the B cell for the original perhaps virus, but this kind of mutations help it to also follow with the antigenic drift that takes place, and the immune system modifies itself towards affinity maturation, particularly and only known right now for the context of T cells. T cells don't get this. Okay? Yeah.
So affinity maturation only happens upon reinfection?
Repetitive infection. So first infection that you will have the B cells that get activated, go through clonal expansion, a cluster of them will end up as memory, a cluster will become plasma cells. Initially, the cell will be only of the IgM secreting type while the T helper comes in. In the meanwhile, when the T helper comes, you will have again them differentiating into, let's say, IgG or IgA secreting plasma cells. They will finish with the infection. You will be left off with the memory pool of the B cells. Now, upon reactivation of the memory pool, you will again get CD4 help coming for the memory pool. Once this happens, these memory cells, this memory cell can be either IgG memory, IgA memory, depending on the type of class switching that has happened already. Now, this cannot class switch any further. What will happen now? You will have mutations induced in this molecule. If it is happening anywhere in the constant domain, no changes and nothing happens as an outcome of that particular mutation. However, if the change happens in the VDJ area, and in particular in the part of the B cell receptor that is supposed to recognize the epitope, it can have either an increased or decreased affinity. If it's a decreased affinity, the clone that did not have that mutation will continue to bind to the antigen, and the antigen specificity may not change. It will be as of the parent. However, if the mutation led to a small transformation in the amino acid pocket over here that binds it much better, it will be able to bind to the antigen in more with more affinity, and therefore displace a B cell which is a weaker affinity to it. And then that clone will expand over time in preference to the parent clone. And that leads to what you call as affinity maturation. Okay? Right. So the enzyme, however, remains the same. It's the activation induced cytidine deaminase that carries out these functionalities. So let's move down to the nitty-gritties, and I'll say that again, to the structures. Okay? So we already discussed this briefly. Structurally, you need to know what a B cell receptor really is. You have a heavy chain and a light chain, and within the heavy chain and the light chain, you've got areas that are variable for the light and variable for the heavy, and then constant for the light and constant for the heavy chain. Constant parts are those that are fixed. The variable parts are those where VDJ recombination or VJ recombination takes place. This is really, really very similar in terms of the variable and the constant part of the T cell receptor, except that the T cell receptor, instead of having a heavy and a light chain, has an alpha chain and a beta chain. Beta chain is almost missile the heavy chain, and the alpha chain is more or less similar to the light chain. So this is very, very similar in structures. Now, it is the combination of the variable part of the alpha and the variable part of the beta chain in the T cell receptor that acts as the antigen recognition domain. And the same thing is true for the B cell receptor, where the variable part of the heavy and the variable part of the light chain together form the antigen binding site. The key difference is that in a B cell receptor, one BCR has actually two antigen binding sites. With this, it has a small area in the middle which is called the hinge region over here. This confers flexibility. Now, this hinge region, these two chains in the B cell, these two B cell receptor chains, the heavy chains, are linked to each other by two disulfide links here, and the heavy and the light chain are linked to each other by a single disulfide. This hinge region is very important. Why? Because a single B cell receptor has two antigen binding sites. The hinge region helps it to change its 3D conformation by bringing them closer or opening them wider. So they all move at the hinge region. So if this is a B cell receptor, it can come closer or wider depending on how closely or how far is the anti or is the antigenic epitope placed on the target antigen. It can be closer or farther apart, and the B cell receptor therefore adapts to that and can change its configuration to bind to it. T cell receptors are fixed, they cannot do that. So they just have to depend on the antigen presentation through the antigen presenting cell and incorporate that change as is. Okay. Now, the commonalities that we come across them is that there's a very small gene segment, but the recombination events that we discussed earlier in year 2 are the ones that give rise to the high diversity. So these are the commonalities in both of them. The rearrangement, you have to understand, is irreversible. It does not change at all. Once it's done, it's done. So the T cell or the B cell receptor, once it is made, it cannot go back and re-change its configuration. Also, remember, once the class switching has taken place, you cannot have further class switching in a cell that has class switched already. Okay. So these are two very important points.
So this will mean the variable part of it, not the constant. The variable part of it, it cannot be changed.
It cannot be
it's
changed.
It's variable, but cannot be changed.
It is called variables because different gene segments code for it, and between one T cell receptor and the other T cell receptor, the change in the amino acids is in the variable parts because the constant remains the same. Similarly, in the B cell receptor, the change in the amino acid sequence is only in the variable parts. The constant parts remain the same for them. They're gene encoded, they don't change. Okay. Now, again, going back to questions that will come to you, okay, from the examination point of view. Don't forget affinity maturation. Affinity maturation is the only place where once the variable part is formed, it can change, okay? Other than that, it will not. And affinity maturation, remember, is restricted to B cells. It is not a property of T cells. So T cell receptor, once it is made, it cannot further modify itself. The B cell receptor also, once it's made, it cannot modify itself except getting point mutations. Okay? And that too in the context of T help. If the T help is not there, activation induced cytidine deaminase doesn't kick in, affinity maturation will not happen. Right? We already discussed about what are the antigenic sources and the sequences. This is just to go back to illustrate to you that a single antigen can have multiple epitopes and therefore activate multiple antibodies, multiple B cells, and therefore two different antibodies that are going to be released by the B cell. This is going back talking about cryptic epitopes that need to be presented. So an epitope which is inside a 3D structure needs to be fragmented and broken down in the context of antigen processing and presentation through MHC, and only then can it be presented. So a B cell cannot recognize this. Okay. Similarly, one more important point is anything that is primarily cytoplasmic and infected cell. Okay. So we talk about viruses, right? And intracellular bacteria. Can you name any intracellular bacteria or virus? Listeria. Good. TB. Good. Viruses.
All.
Okay, fine, try to make it aware, but all. Now, viruses and bacteria let's say these are three cells, epithelial cells, okay? And if a virus is able to gain access to one cell type, how does a virus spread from one cell to the other?
Replicates and then it's burst and then
very good. So one way is that the virus replicates, cell burst makes new viral particles that then can infect the adjacent cell. Another way?
Some cells engulf the infected cells and then they lose them.
True, that is in the case of HIV. Another way?
It subconsciously produces the virus.
Virology, syncytial formation? No? No rings. Okay. So viruses, apart from spreading from outside, because their cells are adjacent to each other, cells are packed to each other. The virus can spread from one cell to another cell by forming syncytia, okay? And just going from one cell to the next cell adjacent. It doesn't need to go extracellular. So what I'm trying to emphasize on the point over here is that in these cases, the viral lifespan outside the cell versus inside the cell is highly variable. Once the virus has infected, primarily the majority of its time is spent inside the cell. Meaning, antibodies that are made against the virus cannot do anything to the virus as long as the virus is propagating or replicating inside. It's only when the virus actually breaks through the cell and makes virons that are spreading out, that's where antibodies are very, very useful at grabbing the virus, blocking the virus, and preventing it from spreading. Okay? Having said that, the most important way to deal with these cell types is through what? Cytotoxic T lymphocytes. Okay? So CD8 T cells that get activated will come and kill a virus-infected cell and thereby remove the breeding ground for the viruses that is going to be. So that is how you deal with viruses particularly. Why am I raising this point? It's because regardless of the outcome, whether it is a T helper 1 response that is targeting viruses or intracellular bacteria, or you have a T helper 2 response against extracellular bacteria. Okay, remember, T cells and B cells both always get activated. Okay, so get this concept clear in your mind. Intracellular infections, although they are managed by cytotoxic CD8 T cells coming and killing a cell that is infected by a virus, it does not mean that B cells are not activated. It does not mean antibodies are not produced. So in all infections that you have, both T and B cells get activated. For intracellular infections, you will have three cell types that get activated. You will have T helper cells, cytotoxic T lymphocytes, and B cells that end up becoming plasma cells. So B cells, plasma cells will secrete the antibodies. T helper will facilitate the formation of T cytotoxic and B cells to make antibody cross switch, and cytotoxic are the ones that are going to go and kill the targets. In extracellular infections, you have T helper and the B cells primarily being synthesized from the adaptive immune response. Cytotoxic T cells are not made because the infection itself is extracellular. Cytotoxic T cells do not have a role in targeting extracellular infections. Okay?
Can intracellular also, like apoptosis can be also in the target cell, can be also induced by antibodies?
Apoptosis induction through antibodies, not known. We engineer and do it. That's a separate story.
So there is no antibody induced apoptosis for.
No, antibodies help to remove apoptotic bodies. For example, let's say that this is a virus-infected cell, okay, and this virus-infected cell is now dying because of the virus itself. So many viral particles are made, right? And one of these apoptotic bodies ends up expressing a viral cell surface, cell membrane, viral membrane protein. It is not a virus, but one of the viral proteins are basically incorporated onto the membrane. Here, the antibody will capture this. This is an apoptotic body, but it will be captured by the same antibody that is targeting the virus. Okay? You understand?
Yeah.
Alright. So, is this all sort of clear to you guys? Any questions still here? Any points? Yeah.
But with the DNA combination, does it happen on both chromosomes or just?
It depends. It starts with one chromosome, fails, go to the next.
Well, it doesn't fail on the first one.
It will form. That's it.
And the second one still has.
Second one remains dormant. It has the ability to transform, but it remains dormant, shut down. So So it will not go through on the second one.
So is there a chance that chromosome can have affected two different epitopes? The activation of the first one succeeds and differentiates. And the second one also has the ability.
Yeah, that is transcriptionally shut down, epigenetics.
Okay,
that possibility exists. You can, in the labs, you can modify that. But biologically, it is not known to happen. Okay? All right, so let's get down to another important point coming back to this part. Okay? Now, your T cells, now the question you guys should have asked me is, what's the point of your own antigen presenting cells sampling your own environment continuously and presenting self-antigen? Okay? Now, the signal that we were talking about over here, I'll just remove all of this. Signal 1 we talked about was for activation, correct? Signal 2 is for?
Survival
and proliferation. Now, let's say, for understanding purposes, that here we have weak affinity, meaning you have a T cell receptor that is recognizing a peptide MHC complex with very weak affinity. That means that a weak signal will go to the nucleus. Okay? On the other hand, let's take this concept and say there's another T cell receptor, different one, that engages the peptide MHC complex and has no affinity. Okay? Yani nothing goes inside. So let's call this A, let's call this B. And let's say third one is strong affinity, and we can call this C. So we have A, B, and strong affinity, C. This is very important. When you have no affinity, no signal goes to the nucleus. When you have weak affinity, a very small signal goes to the nucleus. When you have high affinity, a very strong signal goes to the nucleus. Okay? Is that clear? Now, this is all in the context of how your T cells engage peptide MHCs that are found in your body. Those T cells that have absolutely no recognition of the peptide MHC and have no affinity, these do not get any signal for surviving. So at a basal level, all the T cells in my body have very, very weak affinity for my own peptide MHC. I use the term peptide MHC because they have to recognize peptide in the context of MHC. And most of the times, they are able to, actually, all of them should be able to recognize my MHC, okay? Whether they recognize the peptide or not. That weak interaction keeps my cells in survival mode. If there is no interaction, they die. So let's say that Malakan has a totally different set of MHC molecules than me, all of them, which is a good probability. I come from India, Pakistan, subcontinent region. He's from Syria. Okay? They like goat's sheep and good meat over there. We like vegetables. There's a big difference. So his MHC molecules are totally different. I take a bit of his T cells, purify them. I take only the T cells and put them with my antigen presenting cells. If there is absolutely no affinity, no MHC interaction, his T cells will die out. They will not survive. So at the baseline, your own peptide MHC molecules are required for just giving a weak survival signals to your own T cell repertoire that you have. On the other hand, and that's what happens, most 99% of our interactions actually are of weak affinities. They keep our T cells alive, survival signals. However, it's only the pathogenic ones or your own cells that turn into cancer and therefore the affinity increases, or an infection where you get an activation taking place of your T cells. So the baseline signaling of weak affinity is for survival. Simply, no affinity will lead to death, and strong affinity will lead to activation. Okay? This is the core basic concept that exists. Now, what leads to this T cell getting this interaction and activation? So an antigen presenting cell is like a ball, right? They're like two billiard balls, the T cell and an antigen presenting cell. When they come into contact with each other within the lymph node, they don't stick to each other. Remember, they're just two cells, right? They need to have some sort of weak adhesion interactions for these molecules to align. Remember, you can have, let's say this is the MHC peptide complex, and this is the TCR. This is the antigen presenting cell, and this is the T cell. Even when they come together, they may not align. They may be malaligned. For a T cell to interact with the peptide MHC, these molecules need to be exactly aligned to each other. And remember, they don't bind to each other. They're just two surfaces coming into contact with each other. For them to align, you have adhesion molecules on the surface of T cells and your antigen presenting cells. These are weak adhesion molecules. LFA1 interacts with ICAM1 and ICAM2. ICAM is intracellular adhesion molecule 1, intracellular adhesion molecule 2. LFA1 is leukocyte functional antigen 1. Okay? Now, these weak bindings that take place allow time or give time for a TCR that was somewhere else to softly align with the MHC molecule. And the way a TCR recognizes the MHC molecule is based on the CD8. It's a CD8 molecule that actually binds to the MHC, and the TCR uses CD8 as a reference. So wherever the CD8 is, the TCR will come in a line, and then whatever is parallel to it, it will interact. Okay? Now, if this interaction is weak, this engagement is also very weak, it just allows time for alignment. A weak signal goes inside the T cell for survival, cells move away. If this is a strong affinity interaction here, a strong signal goes inside, and in parallel, a strong signal immediately goes to LFA1. The leukocyte functional antigen 1, it changes its configuration. Based on this signal, it changes its configuration and affinity, and it binds more strongly to ICAM1 or ICAM2. Okay? And based on that strong binding, it allows more time over here for the peptide MHC interaction to take place. This increased time allows for a full strength, strong signal to go inside, allowing full activation to take place. Okay, so one place where you can have immune deficiency in terms of adaptive immune system with everything functioning normal is if these your mutations over here, which do not allow for even a strong affinity interaction to take place. So if you have defective adhesion molecules, LFA1, it will not allow a T cell to get activated properly to the peptide MHC. Okay, that's one kind of immune deficiency you can think of. On the other hand, if you take a weak affinity interaction and you forcibly, by force, keep them engaged with each other, okay, what will happen? This weak affinity interaction will continue, right? Over time, the signal will become strong and you will have activation taking place. Okay? Some bacteria, they secrete toxins that can come and bind here and here together. So they bind the MHC molecule to the peptide TCR, externally bind to them, force them to interact. That's where you get polyclonal expansion. Okay? It may lead to autoimmunity. It can most likely lead to autoimmunity, or it may not lead to autoimmunity. No, it will just give rise to polyclonal expansion. Energy will not happen because it's an infection. Infection has already upregulated CD80 and 86. Okay? Energy will not be induced. So normally we talk about clonal expansion. Clonal expansion takes place when you have one pathogen entering your body, which can have a few epitopes. Against each epitope, you will have those particular clones expanding. Okay? But if you have a pathogen that secretes a toxin that can bind the MHC to the TCR and keep them bind, and it is non-specific. Okay? So many different T cells will get engaged. All of them will have the weak affinity, over time becoming into a strong affinity interaction because it builds up, and it will give rise to polyclonal expansion. These kind of molecules that carry this function out are called as superantigens. Okay? So whenever you have superantigens, you can think of polyclonal expansion, not clonal expansion. Okay? Many different clones of T cells will be expanded, which have got nothing to do with the initial infection. Yeah.
Staph aureus has a superantigens, right?
One, two strains of it. Not all.
What's the consequence of this polyclonal expansion? If it's not, so if we start start invading these cells that has this antigen?
No, so you have the immune system, right? So let's go back to the basic story, right? We talked about three things, right? We talked about
activation.
The signal of activation.
Survival and differentiation.
Good. Survival and differentiation. Central to all of them is something called as clonal expansion, right? We agree?
Yeah.
And clonal expansion is an outcome of these two combined signals, correct? What maintains the size of the clone? How big can clonal expansion take place? We talked about depends on the amount of the antigen.
Number of epitopes or how
true,
many?
True. But the third part that I'm sorry I missed out is also the cytokines. Interleukin 2 is also required for clonal expansion, right? Cytokines maintain the number of cells. Interleukin 7 maintains the number of B T cells in your circulation, correct? The basal amount, just like erythropoietin. The amount of erythropoietin maintains the number of RBCs in your peripheral circulation. Interleukin 7 similarly maintains the basal number of B cells and T cells in your circulation. Similarly, when they're going to clonal expansion, they need excess amount of interleukin 2. When you have interleukin 2 in terms of a superantigen expansion taking place, the pathogen makes sure that it's making those clones expand that are not specific to itself. So the immune response to the pathogen is therefore diminished, even when the global immune response is huge. So the IL-2 will be consumed to activate or expand the numbers of many different clones and not this one specific clone. Okay? So this is one of the ways by which pathogens evade the immune system, by making them busy with something else. Okay? So the rest of the clones that are made will go as effector cells and not find their target to begin with. Okay? And a lot of energy is consumed while the numbers that are required to manage the pathogen are reduced in the overall outcome of the immune response.
Is there any example in your mind for such a pathogen?
We have Steph and then two more. I'll have to go back to microbiology to pull them out. Okay? I'll come back with the second session. I'll make a list of all of those super antigens.
Streptococcus. Streptococcus Jacques syndrome.
Yes, that's one. But there are two or three others as well. Google it out. Why waste time? Google out to see all those that make polyclonal expansions. Okay? All right. So are we okay with this? Are we clear with what affinity means and what expansion means right now?
Good. These are lymphocytes, lymphoid organs. I don't want to go.
So lymphoid, lymph nodes. So this is an important part. This thing I think you know histologically already. I don't need to jump into that area. Let's go back. No. Okay. So just remember the histology of a lymph node versus that of a spleen. This is a second important question that will come up in terms of your exam questions, right? Talking about the mantle zone, the parafollicular zone, etc. And then mucosa associated lymphoid. Right. So this is what we discussed already. Antigen presenting cells types as well. Here. So before I conclude this part of the talk, which we still have a lot of time to discuss. What you need to understand are now three factors. So we started with the amount of antigen that is responsible, okay. We talked a bit about the type of antigen, meaning the number of epitopes. Then we talked about the requirement for certain cytokines that are essential for clonal expansion, okay. And then we talked about the antigens which may not have an increased dose or not have many epitopes, but they might be super antigens just binding things together and giving rise to clonal expansion. But apart from that, the most important thing you need to understand is that a single antigen or a single epitope that expands one clone cannot interact with other clones in general, apart from super antigens. But super antigens are non-specific. You will not have. So each time you give a super antigen, it's going to expand an X number of clones, and the next time it may be Y number. It will be totally haphazard. It's not going to be specific in that number. Now, your antigens, the first time you see an antigen response, you have a certain area, the time which is lost, which is called the lag phase. Where does this time go? The adaptive immune system is slow to respond. Number one, antigen processing. Number two, sorry?
Presentation,
okay. What else?
Expansion.
Sorry?
The clonal expansion.
Clonal expansion, excellent. What else? A little before this?
Migration of the cell.
Innate immunity, antigen processing. Yes?
Migration of the cell.
Migration of the cell. So the migration and trapping of the correct T cell or the correct B cell is very important. Your T cell or the B cell may not be in that lymph node or secondary lymphoid organ when the antigen is already there. Typically, a dendritic cell takes just between 30 and 40 minutes from the time it is encountering a pathogen or an antigen to reach the lymph node, okay? Wherever it is, even the foot pad or the hand, it just takes 30 to 40 minutes to go there. Next, it takes around 2 days approximately.
So in this case, there is no antigen processing, yes? Because there is antibodies, which means B cells. So there is no antigen processing in this.
Doesn't need to be, okay? But going back to it, you still have plasmacytoid dendritic cells, a kind of dendritic cell that is present within the lymph nodes that basically capture the 3D antigen on its surface. Okay, I'll come to that in a moment.
Yeah. So he doesn't need antigen processing.
Need not be antigen processing. Okay. Yes.
Doctor Bounce,
you said that the B cell
has to be specific in order to recognize the epitope,
right? What if that B cell was, like you said, an epitope lymph node? How would it know to go to that specific lymph node? We don't know that. Right now, we don't know that. There are several research groups that are working on trying to see if, for example, T cells that are actually responsible for respiratory viruses, do they tend to remain circulating around the pulmonary system or not? But they have not been able to identify them. So sometimes they have been able to find T cell for respiratory syncytial virus somewhere near the popliteal lymph node. But whether that is a single occurrence for a shorter duration, these studies are too difficult to do in humans to identify. Okay, so they have not been able to identify. Getting back to it, so the initial, you see, 4 to 5 days is an average time point. It need not be always 4 to 5 days. You can have situations where the typical T cell or the B cell is already present within the secondary lymphoid organ when the antigen presenting cell is coming. There, you will have all the processes taking place within 3 days. Okay? Or it may be very far away and it can take up to 5 to 7 days. So it's, this variability is just based on juxtapositioning or the proximity of the T cell or the B cell that is specific for that antigenic epitope to be activated. So regardless of the range, which can decrease or increase, you have a short lag phase, primarily, as she very rightly stated, depending on clonal expansion. As the cells go through a number of expansions during their clonal phase, they start changing their behavior. The cells that are initially getting clonal expansion have a high expression level of CD28 to get co-stimulation, right? We needed some co-stimulation over here. So instead of LFA1 and ICAM, I'll just go back. So you still need co-stimulation. Each time the cell goes back, divides into two, comes back, gets the peptide MHC-TCR engagement, gets the co-stimulation, gets the cytokine signaling, goes back and expands more. These cycles continue. After a number of cycles, what happens is that the progeny, the clonally expanded T cells, they stop expressing CD28 or they downregulate CD28 expression. Sometimes they don't even downregulate, they let the CD28 expression be. But in addition to CD28, they start expressing something called as CTLA4. CTLA4 has a 10 times higher affinity to bind CD80 and 86, thereby blocking CD28 signaling. Okay? And because the CTLA4 expression increases, although they get the peptide MHC engagement, they don't get co-stimulation. These cells do not expand any further. So cells that are ending at the stage of clonal expansion, those cells have high CTLA4 expression as compared to naive cells that have high CD28 expression. These cells now also start expressing, once they have gone through clonal expansion, they start increase cell surface expression of CD44, and they start to migrate out of the lymph nodes. You remember what CD44 was, right? CD44, exactly. Excellent. CD44 is a cell surface marker or a receptor for hyaluronic acid. It was presented on monocytes. Monocytes use the same one to move out from the blood vessel into the tissue. And once they were in the tissue, they used CD44 to engage the extracellular matrix and enlarge and mature to become macrophages. Here also, the CD8 T cells use the same molecule, CD44, to be out in the blood, and from the blood, they're able to migrate into the tissue based on CD44 expression. Remember, CD44 is therefore a marker for metastatic cancers. Even your cancer cells, when they want to move from one part of the body and metastasize to another, breast cancer or any, they use CD44 expression. So cancers, there's a tumor in my right breast, it will metastasize, go into the bloodstream. The moment it's in the bloodstream, it'll have high CD44 expression. For it to migrate anywhere else, move out of the bloodstream and get deposited into secondary tissue sites. So CD44 is an important molecule, for a molecular marker, for multiple reasons. But in principle, it is simply a receptor for hyaluronic acid, which is found in the tissue, extracellular matrix. Okay? So these cells start increasing the expression of CTLA-4, increase the expression of CD44, leave the lymph nodes, go through the bloodstream, and then by the process of chemotaxis, the site where inflammation is taking place, the chemotactic signals drive them to that point of inflammation where they carry out their effector functionality. Okay? Is that clear? Good. So this is all about the migration of T-cells. So initially, they go through the lag phase, go through clonal expansion, and then there is an increased response to antigen. And this process is not like a single time point process. Cells are multiplying, and as they're multiplying, their numbers are increasing. So you can see, you will see a gradual increment in the immune response that is taking place. Okay. And similarly, the responses in terms over here, this curve is reminiscent similarly of T cells, B cells, and antibody. The only thing you will see different in them is the amount. So T cells will also have an expansion similarly. B cells will have an expansion similarly, and antibodies is shown here how they increase in its titers. Eventually, at the end, because the infection is reduced, we said the dose of the antigen maintains the dose of the response. It declines down, and you're left with the memory responses. Okay, and when you have a different antigen or a different pathogen, it is similar to the first response that is seen. So cytokines. What does this mean? The cytokines that you have do not really determine the outcome of the immune response. They support the immune response. You understand what I'm saying? Let's say that I take a high dose of interleukin-2 intravenously. Okay? This will facilitate the expansion of my T cells in an infection. If it is happening. And it will support any infection that is happening, but it will not be the cause of the expansion. You need to have signal 1 and 2, and then signal 3 can potentiate the outcomes.
Why isn't this used then in viral infection?
Sorry?
Why isn't it used then to enhance the immune system in viral infection?
Yeah, that's exactly why people are on COVID on ventilators.
Yeah, why don't they use
IFOM? No, that's how it happens. Too much expansion of the immune system can give rise to cytokine storm. People die because of COVID. You don't want a response that is also over exaggerated. So the people who actually are dying because of COVID are those whose immune systems are overreactive. They're not dying because their immune systems are suppressed. It's an overactive immune response that is leading to that. So similarly, when you have a second response, notice that the lag phase has drastically reduced, okay? Because the memory cells already have made the mRNA for clonal expansion purposes preformed. So there's no gene transcription translation events taking place. They already have a huge pool of IL-2 and other mRNA required for expansion.
And also, affinity maturation?
Affinity maturation is a separate process. No, that is not an outcome of this. Affinity maturation can go both ways. Affinity maturation is basically point mutations. It can decrease affinity, it can increase affinity. Okay? And that is definitely different than what is being represented over. This is just showing that a memory response is far shorter, because all the molecules required for clonal expansion have already been made, those genes have been transcribed, and the cellular level of mRNA is high. So the moment the second time the T cell gets activated, it does not need to go through gene transcription and translation. It just pushes the mRNA to synthesize the proteins. It already has things ready to carry out clonal expansion, and it goes faster. Okay? Yes. All right. So this is just talking about four different kinds of pathogens. We don't need to worry about this too much. But coming back to the antibody responses. So once you have the antibodies that are made and synthesized, you have three different basic outcomes of the antibodies. The antibodies can simply neutralize the product. So if there's a virus, the virus can simply be neutralized from targeting and going to the next cell. Or if it's a toxin, it can be neutralized as well. Again, all antibodies, once they target their end product, they will form antigen-antibody complexes. Antigen-antibody complexes are very important. If you have a circulating antibody which is not bound to the target, the constant part of this antibody, the Fc portion of this antibody, is not recognized by the Fc receptors that were on the different innate immune cells. You remember we talked about the Fc receptors present on macrophages, right? Receptor-mediated endocytosis. Fc receptors are found on macrophages, on neutrophils, on eosinophils, as well as mast cells. They all have Fc receptors, okay? In addition to them, Fc receptors are also found on natural killer cells, okay? Now, if an antibody is in circulation, like I got vaccinated for some pathogen, and those antibodies are somewhere around in the body in circulation, those free circulating antibodies, the Fc part of it, is not recognized by the Fc receptors, unless the antibody binds to its target epitope. When an antibody binds to the target epitope or the antigen, it gives rise to a conformational change in the Fc part, exposing the active site, which can now bind the Fc receptor. Okay? So, regardless of what happens in terms of the antibody's functionality, basically, whenever an antibody binds something, it is going to be taken and removed by receptor-mediated endocytosis. So, we say that because it's binding a toxin, it's neutralizing a toxin, but then receptor-mediated endocytosis. It is binding a bacteria, carrying out opsonization to an extracellular bacteria, but then receptor-mediated endocytosis. It is actually binding to the bacteria and activating complement and leading to complement-mediated ingestion endocytosis and complement activation giving rise to the malformation. Okay, but the end outcome is receptor-mediated endocytosis regardless of the target that it binds to. Okay, except in the cases of natural killer cells. Okay, natural killer cells, if a cell gets infected by a virus, for example, when viruses infect cells, they end up replicating the viral genome, but in addition to viral genome, they also end up replicating or making viral proteins in the host cell. These viral proteins that have been synthesized come on the cell membrane, and as the virus buds off, it takes the host cell membrane with the viral membrane proteins and the viral genome. But before the budding takes place, you can have viral proteins put on the cell's membrane, which will become the viral coat, which will eventually become the viral membrane later on. At this stage, you can have antibodies that can recognize this and bind to it. Once the antibody binds to the viral membrane proteins, it engages the Fc receptors on cells which are called natural killer cells. These natural killer cells, just like cytotoxic CD8 T cells, have perforins and granzymes, okay, that are released and induce activation of caspases that carry out apoptosis in the target cell. Okay? This process of activating natural killer cells through the antibodies is called antibody-dependent cell-mediated cytotoxicity, ADCC. Antibody-dependent because it needs the antibodies, cell-mediated because this is a cell, cytotoxicity. Okay?
So that's what you need to know about that. Of course, you already know this, that cytotoxic T cells can also release pathogenic cells and kill virus infected cells. And I think we will take a pause and stop here. Okay. And start off by maybe how much break do you want? 10 minutes?
I think it's 15 for a prayer.
Yeah, we can take 20 from there. The compartment, which is the phagosome. We already talked about the regular phagocytosis that takes place. We already discussed, we also have receptor-mediated phagocytosis or endocytosis that can take place. What we did not talk about was macropinocytosis. Pinocytosis is a process that kicks in particular situations of stress. When you go through a stage of fasting, your cells go through a stage of what is called as autophagy. So a cell basically makes a small vesicular projection that gets bled out, and then it sends out processes to re-internalize its own part in a vesicle, and this gives rise to a phagosome. The difference is that in a regular phagosome, it's a single membrane. Okay? But here, you have your own membrane doubled with the cytoplasmic contents inside the innermost vesicle that is taken up. Cells usually do this in cases of starvation or stress because they want to use the broken down products of its own cells either for the purpose of synthesis and repair, or they need to use them for making energy. Okay? So either it's an energy or a repair mechanism because of which they take these things in. Now, globally speaking, any cell in your body that has a nucleus, okay, puts things up on its surface through MHC class 1. Any cell that is phagocytic in nature can put things on the surface through MHC class 2. But this phagocytic cell does not mean it doesn't have MHC1. It expresses both MHC1 and MHC2 on the surface, similar to the B cells that are not phagocytic cells but can carry out receptor-mediated endocytosis. Now, what happens in a regular cell at any given time point? We're just talking about any cell in your body that's nucleated. They have the endoplasmic reticulum where your MHC class 1 proteins are being synthesized at any time point. These cells also have in their cytoplasm a cluster of proteins that form a kind of a paper shredder kind of a macromolecular structure. This macromolecular structure is called as a proteasome. So when your cells make proteins that in the endoplasmic reticulum get malfolded, they don't fold properly because either they were synthesized at a high rate, the chaperones that are involved in helping them to fold properly were probably not present over there, or there was any mutation that happened. Regardless of any reason for malfolding, these proteins get pushed to the proteasome. The proteasomal function is sort of recycling. It breaks down the proteins into small peptide fragments. Alternatively, you may have a protein on the cell surface. You may have a sodium potassium ATPase exchanger, and the cell probably does not require it anymore. Any protein that is on the membrane or the cytoplasm, enzymatic or otherwise, if it's not needed, the cell, a signal goes to it and they add many ubiquitins in sequence, not in parallel, one ubiquitin to another. Once any protein is tagged with ubiquitin,
it acts as a signaling sequence for this protein to be dragged down and degraded by the proteasome. Okay. Similarly, any protein that is inside the cell gets exposed to UV light, etc., and gets and changes its shape or gets denatured, also gets down to the proteasome and gets degraded. Now, all these breakdown products of the proteasome, they get pumped by active transport into the endoplasmic reticulum, these peptide sequences, and there are two proteins, TAP1, TAP2, that use ATP to actively transport these peptide sequences into the endoplasmic reticulum. Inside the endoplasmic reticulum, you have the MHC class 1 protein being synthesized, and these peptide fragments that have been thrown into the endoplasmic reticulum get loaded onto this MHC class 1 protein. This MHC class 1 protein molecule then moves to the corner, goes to the Golgi, buds off, and eventually this molecule moves to the surface where it infuses with the cell membrane, and cell peptides are therefore expressed on the surface of the cell. Okay? This is happening in any cell of your body at any given time. And a basal level of MHC class 1 is expressed. In cases of inflammation, when you have infection taking place, particularly of viral origin, you have from your environment interferons signaling taking place. Interferons tend to slightly upregulate the cell surface expressions of MHC class 1 molecules, okay, thereby increasing the antigen processing. What also happens is that in these cells, the proteasome gets changed slightly. Two or three moieties or subunits of this get changed. And instead of a regular proteasome, it becomes an immunoproteasome. Immunoproteasome is not anymore requiring ubiquitin for dragging proteins in. Any protein that is inside, it gets dragged in and peptide fragments are produced. Therefore, when any cell gets infected by a virus and viral proteins are being synthesized in the cells, all those viral, and of course the cell goes under the process of stress, interferons are produced. These viral peptide fragments through the immune proteasome are actually degraded at a faster rate, get loaded onto MHC class 1 and go to the cell surface. So whenever you have intracellular infections, the viral peptide sequences end up on the cell surface at a faster rate for antigen presentation. The same outcome is actually expected when you have an antigen presenting cell, whether it's a macrophage or a dendritic cell. Okay? But for a macrophage and a dendritic cell to carry out any viral peptide expression on the surface, you would normally think that this cell itself needs to get infected first, right? Because any protein or peptide that is cytoplasmic eventually goes to MHC class 1. So MHC class 1 gets your cytosolic peptide sequences, right? Any peptide in the cytosol ends up on MHC class 1. So you can imagine that for an antigen presenting cell, it first needs to get infected by the same virus that the cell is infected and then do it. But that's not the case, because viruses are specific. They just don't go haphazardly infecting all cell types. They need specific target receptors based on which they target the next cell in line. Okay? So what happens in antigen presenting cell is a slightly different process. An antigen presenting cell may phagocytose a cell that is infected by a virus or dying or has been killed by a virus, apoptotic bodies, and therefore phagocytose and pick up these viral peptides Once inside, in the phagosome, the normal pathway is for MHC class 2 to come here, pick the viral peptides on the phagosome and go to the surface. So the peptide can easily be expressed on MHC class 2. For MHC class 1, certain changes have to happen. And one of the changes that happens is after the proteasomal degradation has taken place, again, bicarb is pumped in and reverse proton pumping takes place. So the pH that was acidic in this vesicle, initially in the phagolysosome, it neutralizes again, and then the phagolysosome membrane integrity is broken off. So whatever was phagocytosed now is released into the cytoplasm of the antigen presenting cell. From here, it follows the same pathway, getting loaded onto MHC class 1 and goes to the surface. So basically, your peptide sequences for infection, from infections, end up both on MHC class 1 and MHC class 2 eventually. Okay, that's where this process of releasing the peptides inside is basically called cross presentation, because normally it will not happen. So cross presentation basically takes MHC class 1 cytosolic protein through phagocytosis, releasing it into the cytoplasm. Okay, and it can go the other way. If the antigen presenting cell is actually infected, okay, for example, HIV is able to infect dendritic cells. So when the HIV has infected the dendritic cell, in that case, the dendritic cell will, under this situation of stress, will bud its own cytoplasm out, which may have proteins which are being made for HIV. And then it will re-phagocytose it back in again. Okay? And when it phagocytoses it back in again, it goes to MHC class 2. Okay? So this is again cross-presentation. So by cross-presentation, cytosolic proteins can, vesicular proteins or peptides can end up into the cytoplasm, go to MHC class 1. And cytosolic proteins can go into a vesicle and go into MHC class 2. So this is antigen cross presentation, where antigens get expressed in the other areas. However, this is not the dominant way of antigen presentation. So although antigens are processed and go both MHC class 1 and 2, there tends to be a preference of dominancy over cytosolic to the vesicular, and vesicular over cytosolic. Okay? So the pathways maintain their integrity strongly. So any protein that is cytoplasmic will be expressed more on MHC class 1 rather than MHC class 2, and anything that is extracellular or vesicular will be phagocytosed and presented more on MHC class 2 than MHC class 1, even in the presence of cross presentation. Okay, so that's basically what happens here. So there are two basically proteins, TAC1 and TAC2, that are at the membrane of the endoplasmic reticulum. They come from the same, you don't need to know ATP binding cassette domain, you don't need that, just know that they are ATP dependent mechanisms. And this is the basic core chamber of the immunoproteasome, where things get degraded by the proteasomal pathway. What you need to know is this area basically that we were talking about. So MHC class 1 has another small protein associated with it called nexin that actually helps in protein uploading when the proteasomal degradation takes place. There are other proteins called ERAP that actually further fragment the peptide sequences to the size of MHC class 1. You remember MHC class 2 could take larger peptide fragments up to 24 amino acids, and MHC class 1 can take only smaller ones. That is basically maintained by ERAP inside. You don't need to know the details, okay? But what happens then next, what you need to now understand is that different viruses try to prevent the peptide loading into MHC class 1. These viruses or these pathogens use these processes as mechanisms to evade the immune system. And the way they do that is by they block the peptide entry into the endoplasmic reticulum, herpes simplex, human cytomegalus, bovine does that. Or they can block that the MHC class 1, once it's loaded with the peptide, does not go to the surface of the cell and remains within the endoplasmic reticulum. Adenovirus, HCMV, and murine cytomegalovirus do that. Some viral signals make sure that the MHC class 1 is actually degraded very fast. So instead of the MHC class 1 getting loaded to the surface, they actually drag the MHC class 1 molecule and push it to the proteasomal degradation pathway. So instead of MHC class 1 protein getting loaded with peptide to the surface, it gets tagged with ubiquitin and gets degraded by the proteasome. So they try different mechanisms to prevent their antigens from reaching the cell surface. Or they actually bind the MHC class 1 at the cell surface extracellularly so that the T cell receptor cannot engage with them. So they block it from the outside. So there are multiple mechanisms by which the viruses try to evade these whole processes and block the mechanisms of uploading. In either case, regardless of what the viruses try to do, the end result will be that in the cell, after you have the signaling coming from interferon, different mechanisms used by the virus will eventually decrease the surface expression of MHC class 1. Okay? If the virus is using evading mechanisms. This is where the natural killer cells have a crucial role. Because if MHC class 1 expression is suppressed on the surface of a cell, the cytotoxic CD8 T cell cannot recognize this cell as a target cell and kill it. NKT cells, we already discussed this briefly before, have three main functional outcomes. They use Fc receptors to target any viral protein on the surface and release perforins, granzymes. Perforins make hole in the membrane. Granzymes go in and activate caspases. Alternatively, NK cells can use this to engage on the target cell. All cells have a receptor on the surface called death receptor called FAS, F-A-S. And natural killer cells have a FAS ligand. The ligand binds to FAS, leads to trimerization. Yani three FAS will come together to form a trimer. The moment it forms a trimer, it signals again to the cell to induce apoptosis. Cytotoxic T cells use the same mechanism. Now, this is how they kill the target cell. Now, NK cells have two receptors that we talked about. Killing inhibitory receptors, KIRs, or NKG2D. Natural killer cells have CD16, CD56. Remember these two markers, 1-6 and 5-6. These two are the main receptors on the surface by which you can recognize that this cell is a natural killer cell. The NKG2D is a natural receptor that can get engaged and it can kill a target cell. Normal cells produce on the surface MHC class 1. MHC class 1 is a ligand for killing inhibitory receptors. So as long as the cell is expressing MHC class 1 on the surface, it keeps inhibiting the natural killer cell, keeps blocking it. By inhibition, the natural killer cell does not express FAS ligand and does not release perforin and granzymes, remain in a quiescent state. The natural killer cell already has made in its granzymes perforin and granzymes, it just gets blocked from release. So your natural killer cells across your body have that. What happens when your MHC class 1 levels drop? The signaling through killing inhibitory receptors decreases. I mean, there's a strong signal, now the signal becomes weak. Cells under state of stress, when they're metabolically stressed, even when, you know, people go out and they do a lot of physical activity, they can get stressed. Those cells under stress, or even heat shock stress, or burn, or injury, yani they're not dead, but they're just in a state of stress, they increase cell surface expression of two proteins. M1CA and M1CB. Okay. These proteins are expressed on the surface of cells as an outcome of stress. These two proteins act as ligands for NKG2D. Okay? So if a cell is, so a cell can be stressed but have a lot of MHC1 expression. In that case, the natural killer cell, even when it gets a signal through NKG2D, it gets a negative signal from killing inhibitory receptor and does not degranulate. If the cell is stressed to the point that the balance of M1C and B is far more than the MHC class 1, I mean the ratio shifts, although there is an inhibitory signal, the signal to degranulate through NKG2D overrides and the natural killer cell will kill the target. Now in cases of viral infections, when viruses block the TAC protein, or they drag the MHC class 1 through proteasomal degradation, or they use any mechanism by suppressing MHC class 1, even if the stress protein levels are not high, just because this is not there anymore, the NKG2D is not opposed anymore. It is free to function, and the natural killer cells kill the target cell. So natural killer cells are really, really crucial for killing cells that are going under stress through apoptosis. Viral infected cells, particularly who try to induce viral immune evasion mechanisms, and also cells that are cancerous. So cells that have tumors or cancers, these cells are in a state of metabolic stress because the tumors are multiplying very rapidly. Rapidly multiplying tumors have a hypoxic microenvironment, right? And that hypoxia induces stress, leading to increased expression of M1C and B. So that's what killer cells kill all three different cell types, okay? And they are regulated through MHC class 1 proteins. So the take-home message that you have over here is MHC class 1. So if you get questions, right? So the questions that you get, if they're just asking you the basal outcome of anything, they're not like putting in a story of cross-presentation. So anything that is cytoplasmic ends up into MHC class 1. Anything that is extracellular and needs to be phagocytosed tends to go to MHC class 2. However, when the story comes in of cross-presentation, then you have the extracellular vesicles phagocytosed and the products released in the cytoplasm and then go to MHC1. Or you can have the cytoplasmic proteins released in a vesicle from the body, autophagy then takes place, taking it back in, and then going to MHC class 2. This whole process is cross-presentation that you need to be careful about and know. This is all about antigen processing and presentation that takes place in the macrophages or dendritic cells. In a normal cell type, you need to understand all self antigens at any given time point are expressed on the surface of the cell in the context of MHC class 1, because all your proteins are regularly being degraded by the proteasome. In case of viral infections, the inflammation increases the upregulation of MHC class 1. That whole process is required to facilitate either killing through natural killer cells or cytotoxic CD8 T cells, so they can differentiate better between the signaling that needs to be done. MHC class 1, if it is well expressed on the surface, it will also increase the expression of the pathogen's antigen, and therefore it will become susceptible to cytotoxic CD8 T cells. If the virus tries any immune evasion mechanism, it is always at the level of MHC class 1, either peptide loading, because MHC class 1 does not surface if the peptide is not loaded. If there's no peptide loaded over here, it will remain inside the endoplasmic reticulum. It will not go to the surface. It's only after the peptide loading that it goes to the surface. So either you can block the peptide from entering the endoplasmic reticulum. If the peptide has entered, you can take the peptide loaded MHC class 1, tag it with ubiquitin and let it degrade so it doesn't go to the surface. Or you don't, even if it's loaded, it remains blocked within the endoplasmic reticulum. Or if it goes to the surface, then it gets blocked from interaction with MHC class, with the TCR. That is the only place where your natural killer cell and the TCR will not work. Okay? Because the natural killer cell will still recognize it as MHC1 on the surface, but the TCR will not be able to engage it. Okay? Other than that, any process that blocks is usually at the peptide loading or the MHC egress. Both blocked, the natural killer cells will be the key cells in that case to manage the inflammation or the infection. Okay? Yeah.
In this case, cross-presentation will not help as well, right?
Cross-presentation is a parallel process happening in the antigen-presenting cell. Mm-hmm. This is a separate story about the infection taking place in the tissue. Mm-hmm. So, your tissues have no antigen-presenting cell. I'm talking about the normal architecture of the tissue. In that case, all nucleated cells only have MHC class 1 on their surface.
Okay?
Okay? So, cross-presentation, we're talking about antigen presentation in the antigen-presenting cell, which may be in the tissue, but that is a separate cell type that we're talking about.
Doesn't, in scenarios when there's an infected cell, it loses its MHC1 and it also gets targeted by NK cells?
That's exactly what we talked about.
So
MHC class 1 is lost because viruses will prevent peptide loading to MHC. The virus infecting the cell will degrade, will target the MHC molecule to be degraded, okay, or it will let it remain stagnant within the endoplasmic reticulum and not surface.
Yeah. But you said when is the scenario when CD4 when we don't have CD4 or NK cells working?
CD4 is the
when we don't have T cells and NK working.
T cells and NK cells don't work in particular viral infections where the virus itself secretes proteins that come and actually engage here. So the MHC class 1 is on the surface,
so it's not
presenting the antigen, but a viral protein will come and bind to it, blocking the T cell receptor from engaging it properly.
So the
TCR will not work, but because the MHC is up there, this part of the MHC class 1 is available for killing inhibitory receptor to engage. In that case, the NK cell will recognize the MHC class 1 on the surface and not kill the target. Okay?
So NK, oh yeah.
Okay?
Good.
Any more questions?
Doctor?
Yeah?
NK cells are always residing in the tissues, they don't migrate, right?
They are tissue resident and in the circulation, in the blood. So the NK cells, T cells with NK cells develop in the thymus. After that, T cells remain within secondary lymphoid organs and circulation. NK cells remain in circulation and tissue, mainly.
Does this mean that NK and the cytotoxic T cells do not work together?
No, actually they work together. Okay? But they complement each other. But at any given time point, in almost all cases of infection, M1CA increases because it's a stressed cell. The viral infection has asked the cell to make too many proteins very fast, right? And the virus is replicating at a higher rate. So M1CA expression goes up, creating an imbalance between MHC1 and M1C. So normally MHC class 1 expression is high, M1C is low. Stress cell increase this. Okay? So natural killer cell will kill this cell type based on M1C and M1CB expression through AKG2D. Okay? Now, considering this, MHC class 1 expression is still taking place for antigen presentation. So a little while later, cytotoxic T cells will come in as well and kill this target cell using CD8 T cell recognition of the peptide in the MHC class 1.
Mm-hmm.
So in viral infections, NK cells are the first ones to react, just like neutrophils are the first ones to react in bacterial extracellular infections. So while the virus is replicating and the CD8 T cells are going through that lag phase, you remember we discussed, about clonal expansion.
Yeah.
So while the CD8 T cells are going through antigen processing, presentation, trapping, and clonal expansion, 4 to 5 days, NK cells are usually active, trying to limit the virus. But they cannot, but because the numbers themselves are limited, they cannot only by themselves contain the viral infection. Now they get support from cytotoxic CD8 T cells that come in, and the cytotoxic CD8 T cells come and kill the rest of the virus infected cells. Okay, so they both work in parallel with each other. There are, the only examples I was talking about are very specific cases where viruses, some of them use mechanisms to evade the immune system, and thereby they block MHC class 1. In those cases, it's only the NK cells that will have to take care of the viral load, and the CD8 T cells, they cannot really do it. Okay?
So, Doctor, the CD8 cells won't produce any response to MICA, right?
No, not that is known. Okay? It's a stress protein that is increased. Any other questions today till we conclude? Okay. So, take home messages. You guys need to go back, quickly review the cross-presentation of antigens. Just review how antigen processing presentation takes place. What are the global overall responses of killing target cells? The NK cells and cytotoxic T cells use the same mechanisms. They use receptor-mediated killing, that is fast and fast ligands. They release products to kill, which is granzymes and perforins. Both of the cytotoxic T cells and natural killer cells use the same target mechanisms of cytotoxicity. So know that. We talked about T cell expansions. We talked more in depth actually about what is an antigen, what is the property of an antigen, what are epitopes, what is clonal expansion, how does clonal expansion take place, what regulates the amount of clonal expansion, the amount of antigen, the availability of the cytokines that are there. We also talked about what is non-specific activation in terms of getting polyclonal immune responses, where you have toxic shock syndrome toxin that can be introduced, okay? And they can give rise to any T cells getting activated in particular, because, and then we talked about in particular the strong signaling that you can get from the cognate peptide MHC, the weak signaling that is required for survival, and no signaling that will just simply kill the T cells from the nerves. Just expanding on this very important concept, thank you for bringing this up, okay, this discussion. Now the natural killer cells are designed to recognize your own MHC molecule. Okay, so the moment I do an organ transplantation, let's say I take his kidney and we have a different MHC mismatch, the natural killer cell will come to this new organ, which is already stressed because of the surgery, slightly, expressing more M1C and B, and it does not recognize his MHC class 1 molecules. So the natural killer cells will start killing this transplanted organism. So even in transplantation, natural killer cells will come and start targeting the tissue. Okay? So remember that as well. So we discussed these things. We discussed about cross-presentation of antigen and uploading. Tomorrow, we will focus a little more in depth about the differentiation of adaptive immune system and their responses thereof. We talked today very briefly about the B cells in terms of their affinity maturation. That is a very important concept you need to remember. But remember, affinity maturation is always after class switching, not before. Because the first place where the enzyme would like to go is act on activation-induced cytidine deaminase. First acts on switch sites, then after it is done class switching, it is still activated, and it is always activated through CD40-40 ligand interaction, and therefore it will induce activation-induced cytidine deaminase again. And now on the second, third, fourth, fifth time, when you're engaging the pathogen, you get through a process of affinity maturation. And that is again only B cells, antibodies, not on T cells. Okay? So you're the only way where your receptors, the immune receptors, get edited is in the B cell affinity maturation processes. And that still requires CD4 T help. Okay? So these are the most important takeaways from today. IL-7 is crucial for maintaining the population of the T lymphocytes, just like erythropoietin is required for the maintaining the population of RBCs. What else is core for today? I think that's more or less it. But tomorrow we'll start a little bit about, quickly we'll go through the BDG recombination and all the process by which the T cells are developed. And then we will go further into discussing the role of the effector T cell population. CD4 particularly will be in discussion. CD8, you know that already. Just go back and review the memory responses a little more yourself, very briefly. Just know that it's shorter, faster to act, and stronger, okay? Remember those things in terms of both cellular responses and the products they make. Both are stronger because they already have preformed mRNA. So those are the important components. Tomorrow we talk about development and helper effector responses. That will and I will also jump back to the innate immunity and just run through different cell types and their functionality. Natural killer cells, we did them already, but we'll go to neutrophils, we'll go to eosinophils, we'll go to basophils and talk about their functionality and what they do. Neutrophils, extracellular traps, going back a bit to the toll-like receptors and engaging them as well. So we'll finish with that part tomorrow. And day after, we'll focus on the role of these that we discussed today in immune deficiency syndromes and states. For example, you have people with primary immune deficiencies with hyper IgM syndrome, right?
AIB mutation.
Sorry?
Hyper IgM is AIB mutation, cannot class switch.
CD40 ligand mutation, not inducing AID, cannot class switch, okay. Correct. But that comes back to the same point. In those cases, you cannot have affinity maturation, okay? You understand what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Because in hyper IgM syndrome, you're gonna have a lot of IgM being made because the CD4 help cannot be provided because they don't have CD40 ligand expression on their surfaces, then you cannot have affinity maturation. So just remember these key points in your mind, okay? Although they have more repetitive frequent infections, they will not have affinity maturation. Okay? So we'll discuss those things.